Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. As Alex says, my name's Chris Ghika, and I'm the General Officer commanding London District, which means I command all the army in London, or if you want it another way, if you're inside the M25 and you're in army uniform, you belong to me. Thank you very much indeed for coming today. The room is full of very busy people with packed diaries, so I really appreciate you giving up some time to come and do this morning. I've been the General Officer commanding London District for about 3 months now. It was a small break for Christmas in there. But I have, on and off through 28 years of military service, served in London at pretty much every rank, between the rank of Second Lieutenant and Major General. So I come with some experience of London, but I've never served in the London District Headquarters. So for me, it's a privilege and a pleasure to do the job and to see the issues from this side. Today's conference is an opportunity to be able to discuss the delivery of the armed forces government at a local level in London, to understand the support that is available, and to hear about the good work that has been taking place. And there's a range of speakers today from a number of different sectors who I think will prove really instructive. I always think it's helpful when you're dealing with the Covenant, talking about the Covenant, to remind ourselves what the Covenant is and why it exists. And I am struck by the number of audiences and people I talk to who even now get some elements of it wrong. The Covenant is an enduring contract between the people of the United Kingdom, the government, and those who serve or have served and their families. The armed forces protect the nation and fulfill a responsibility on behalf of the government. And our families provide an absolutely critical supporting role. Without them doing what they do, we could not do what we do. And the Armed Forces Covenant ensures that those who have served in the past and their families and those serving today should face no disadvantage compared to other citizens in the provision of public and commercial services. You will all know that, I know that, but I am surprised by those who don't know that or who misinterpret the wording in the Covenant. It's really important. This is our sixth annual Armed Forces Covenant conference here in London, and the aim is to get as many key stakeholders together as we can to discuss the delivery of the Covenant at a local level. And today's conference will concentrate on collaborative working. That, I think, really important, because when you strip it back and think about it, the Covenant is actually about knowledge and about collaborative working from a variety of different bodies and different groups. So I think that theme is absolutely right. These conferences have been very useful in the past in helping us to identify good practice, where the challenges still lie, and how we can overcome them. And you and your colleagues are really the experts in this area. You have either a particular sector knowledge, you represent a particular group or area, and when you put those together, that is what makes the Armed Forces Covenant work. The Armed Forces Covenant annual report was published in 2019, and I think it's maybe a good moment, 6 weeks on, to sort of have a quick think about what that report highlighted. And to me, when I read it, it showed us that we have made substantial progress over the last year. Maybe more important than that, that the progress was greater than the year before. In other words, this is an ever-increasing story of progress. So the creation of the Office of Veterans Affairs, and I'm really pleased that Damian Patterson is here and is going to speak to us today. The introduction of flexible service, allowing service personnel to amend the time at which they spend at work if they have other pressures on their time. The launch of the Future Accommodation Model pilot, allowing service personnel greater choice and more flexibility in how they're accommodated. The extension of the Forces Help to Buy scheme out to December 2022, allowing people to get a foot on the property ladder. Over 1,000 new signings of the Armed Forces Covenant in 2019, taking the total signatories to over 4,000. And £5 million of funding for the DWP to bolster the role of Armed Forces champions. That's all really important and comes at a sort of national level. Looking more locally in London, four local authorities have revisited their original pledge and re-signed the Covenant. Six have received Armed Forces awareness training for frontline staff, totaling over 170 council staff trained, with five planned in the near future. Seven authorities have now established a Covenant stakeholder meeting. 11 have embraced tailored Armed Forces e-learning initiatives. 12 have signed up to the Defence Employer Recognition Scheme. and 17 now have an armed forces specific web page, which is really important. To me, those figures are really important. They are a signal of what you are all doing. But it is, again, it's all about incremental progress, ever greater awareness. And through progress and awareness comes support to our families, their veterans, and serving soldiers. A little bit about London District. I thought it might be helpful to say what we do, what London District does. I run the London District. Our headquarters is in the Horse Guards building, for those of you who don't know it, right across the road from the Ministry of Defence. It's been there for several hundred years, so we're all sort of rather transitory folk who come in for a few years and then go. And every morning when I come to work, there's a board I walk past showing my successors back to 1856, which kind of puts a little perspective for somebody like me on my tenure in this role. But we do a number of things. The first is we are the people who organize and deliver state ceremonial and public duties, trooping the colour, state visits, national remembrance, all the way down to daily changing of the guard ceremonies. The second thing we do is we are prepared to carry out operations in the UK in support of the emergency services. So you'll have seen that with troops supporting the Metropolitan Police Service in the summer of 2017 after the Manchester attacks. You see it in response to disasters where the troops support the emergency services in the provision of assistance in whatever they're asked to do. The third thing we do is we engage and we inform London about the army. And my phrase is to tell London about us, the army, because we are your army. We belong to the nation. But it is surprising how few people in the country have either an experience or have been touched by the armed forces. Two generations ago, I read some research that said that 85% of the British population had been touched in some way by the armed forces. Today, that figure is under 4%. And so we have a job and a duty and a responsibility, I think, to tell the country about their own army. That army in London, that Navy, that Air Force in London is reasonably large. We have 5,500 regular and reserve soldiers, 1,000 regular and reserve Royal Naval personnel, 1,500 regular and reserve Royal Air Force personnel, 8,000 cadets and their families, making an overall audience of 20,000. There are 2,000 married quarters for families in London, and over 1,200 service children are educated in the capital. So for us, this is core business. It's core business to a lot of our people, and it really matters. Your contribution as representatives, providers of a sector, or of representatives of part of the armed forces is, if I may, to talk to each other, because the more the collaborative working, the more the interaction, the more the personal relationships build up, the more we can do for our people. Before I hand over to Dr. Jonathan Leach, I think just one last thing from me, for those of you who may depart before lunch, is to say from me to all of you a very personal and heartfelt thank you for what you do. I spent two jobs with the American Army, and they do this sort of thing in a much more industrial fashion than we do. The Armed Forces Covenant, I think, getting into its stride now and really delivering. But in America, this kind of thing is absolutely standard. And so I'm really, really thrilled to see that the Covenant in London is going from strength to strength. So if I may, just to say thank you very much indeed for what you do for our serving soldiers, for their families, and for the work that they carry out. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Dr. Jonathan Leach from the NHS. Thank you.